Here at Christian Assembly, family is servanthood. Jesus came to save us and to show us how to serve the Father. He washed his disciples' feet. Here was the King of Glory washing his stinky, dirty, dusty disciples' feet. His blood, his sacrifice compels us to surrender our lives and to make him our Lord. And using whatever gifts we have to make a difference in this church, in this locality, in this generation, here, and around the world. With a renewed sense of purpose, we as a body of believers are committing ourselves to laying down our lives for His will, His plans, His purpose. Allow God's grace to flow through you to reach a lost and dying generation, to build up the body of Christ, and to experience a deeper walk with Him. Jesus is coming soon. The question is, how will you occupy until He comes?
Welcome to the teaching ministry of Bill Anzavino, pastor of Christian Assembly Family Church in Ohioville, Pennsylvania. We pray you are challenged in your walk with the Lord through the following teaching. For more information about Christian Assembly Family Church or to subscribe to our free podcasts, please visit us on the web at cafamily.net.
Go ahead, give him a shout of praise. Hallelujah. His grace is more than enough. Amen. Hallelujah. Father, we love you so much and thank you for your presence here among us this morning as we honor you in this place. Be glorified in all that is said and all that is done, and we'll be certain to give you the praise that you deserve, for you're a good God, great and mighty. We thank you for saving the lost, healing the sick, setting the captives free, meeting every need. And Father, for transforming our lives that we might become the people that you would have us to be, your ambassadors to reach this lost and needy world, dear Father, with the life-changing truths of the gospel. Be glorified in all things, Father, in Jesus' precious name, amen. Amen. Go ahead and greet somebody before you're seated there this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Have you been redeemed this morning? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you an heir of God, a joint heir with Jesus? Are you an ambassador for Christ? Are you holding forth the word of life to this generation? Are you a shining light, letting your light shine among men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven? Amen. Are you? Praise God. Aren't you glad to be redeemed? Are you on fire? Is there a burning in your bones? Praise God. Have you got the Holy Ghost on the inside of you? Praise God. The whole Godhead, Father, Son, Holy Ghost, living where? Inside you. Praise God. Can you imagine that? He thought so much of you, he wanted to come and live inside you. Sometimes I don't want to live inside me. How about you? But he made a decision to come and live inside you. You must be somebody special, somebody important. Amen. Are we blessed this morning? Praise God. Thanks be to God. Greater is he that's where? In us than he that is in the world. Praise God. Where's Brother Cliff at? Where's Brother Cliff at? I was being detained. Detained? Well, let's talk to the detainees and set you free right here. He wants to share a quick testimony of what God's done. Amen? Amen. Praise God.
Oh, I'm going to stand by this big guy. Hey, that's all right. Can you hear me? Everybody hear me? All right. I'm going to show you something. A couple weeks ago, my wife had to dress me, to take me to the hospital. I couldn't put my socks on. And I had a flare-up of arthritis. And 9 years ago it happened, they had to put cortisone on my shoulders, which was minimal. This time, I was getting ready to sell my motorcycle and the camper, you know. All the things you work for, plus your securities. So I got a cheat sheet because I get emotional when I'm in front of so many beautiful people. And other than needy calling me about every 5 minutes to check on me, she's my favorite cousin-in-law. And Jim, he's the backup. He don't say much. He's very bashful. But since I never forget nothing when I'm speaking in front of people and nervous, I got a cheat sheet. I wanted to say to the husbands, try listening to your wife once in a while. Because when they tell you something, like go to the emergency room, you should listen. So after 3 days of, I didn't tell her, but I couldn't get my socks on one morning. So I finally got them on by all kind of tricks, and then I got dressed and went about my way. But I was hurting, grouchy, grumpy, and picked on her a lot. But I just want to tell you guys, start listening. So after 3 days of a lot of problems, I finally listened to her at 3:30 a.m., went to the emergency room, and they started running all the tests because they can make sure you're not on drugs and acting foolish. So after they ran about 3 hours of tests and x-rays and everything, they gave me this pill called prednisone at 7 a.m. So we left the hospital, and by noon, I was outside getting my camper ready for a trip. And I want to say it's amazing, the prayers and the use your doctors, because they're here because God put them here. And I know people who will suffer for a long time, and I'm one of them, thinking that it's just going to go away. Okay, I'll get to the rest of it so I can let my buddy here do his job. Keep laughing, that's why I'm here. I want to thank Pastor Bill and Chuck, because Chuck even called and checked on me because probably the pastor made him. But we know better than that. But I want to thank my beautiful wife, Teresa. And that's her name now, because on my phone, Teresa's way down on the list, and I'm not a techie phone person, you know. She has to tell me how to use it about every 5 minutes. And my granddaughter put her as beautiful wife, so she'd be at the top of the list with the ace base. And that's when I dial, I say, and if I don't tell Siri to call beautiful wife, they don't know what I'm talking about. Okay. But I want to thank you all for the prayers that was given and everything. And it makes a world of this difference. And there's a young lady in the back. Her name is Rose France. She sent me a beautiful card, and I appreciate that, Rose. Edie and Jim always are there when I need them, because that's just the way they are. And like I said, I was good enough and feeling good enough. I got the camper ready, went to West Virginia for a reunion that I've probably missed two since I was an infant for sickness or work. And my grandfather bought the place, great-grandfather bought the place over 200 years ago. We went to the 143rd reunion consecutively and my siblings and I owned 30 acres, and I had electric put on it for my camper. And it worked out very nice. Okay, I'm almost to the end. Okay. But after 6 days of very peaceful rest, looking at the mountainside and the animals, and picking morel mushrooms for my sandwiches up until next to the last day, and I really feel good, and God bless you, and I appreciate everybody.
Amen. Praise God.
Thank you.
Praise God. Also, did you notice that we've got our 7th to the 12th grade working as helpers and ushers here today? Let's thank the Lord for their lives. We serve a great God, don't we? He's done great and mighty things for us, and it's a wonderful thing for us to be able to serve Him, give it back to Him, and serve Him, and that's what they're doing, and so we thank God. Also, we have coming up right now our videos, video announcements, but before the video announcements go on, just a quick note, we're going to announce about the movie night, but if you haven't paid for the movie night, make sure that you get your money in to pay for movie night. So that's on it, so watch the video and be blessed.
Welcome to the video announcements here at Christian Assembly Church.
We're like the bulletin, but better looking.
There is a brief leadership meeting after the service today for all teachers and leaders from all departments.
Tomorrow, May 6th, there will be a nursing home outreach at Trinity Oaks at 6 p.m. Consider being used by God to reach the elderly with love of Jesus.
This Wednesday, May 8th, will be our annual Run for the Sun service for the Christian Motorcycle Association. A brief video will be shown, and a second offering will be taken in support of this biker missionary outreach.
Next Saturday, May 11th, is a very busy day here at the church. First, the men's ministry and breakfast will take place in the fellowship hall at 9 a.m.
Also, there will be an all-church yard sale from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. here in the church parking lot. Anyone from the community is welcome to set up. The cost for each space is $10, and the proceeds go to missions. It's a great time of year to clean out your house and turn your clutter into treasure. Contact Sherry Bruno for more information.
Lastly, movie night will also be on the 11th from 6 to 9 p.m. Pizza dinner will begin at 6 p.m. in the fellowship hall. We will be watching God's Not Dead 3, A Light in the Darkness. The cost will be $5 per person. That's a really good deal, honestly.
Next Monday, May 13th, will be the nursing home outreach at Beaver Meadows at 6 p.m. Again, please consider being used by God to minister to the residents living there.
Tuesday, May 14th, will be the singles meeting at 6 p.m. in the fellowship hall. This is open to singles of all ages. Bring a snack to share and see Mickey DeLons for more information.
Sunday, May 19th, will be our membership and dedication Sunday. If you are 18 years or older, you should consider becoming a member here at Christian Assembly. Please see the main office for the membership forms.
And we really had a baby boom here at the church. If you have a youngling you would like to have dedicated to the Lord, please see the church office no later than May 12th for the proper dedication forms.
June 22nd will be Faith Night at PNC Park. So all you Power fans out there, bring your A game on faith. Cost is $32 per person, and the first 48 to sign up get to ride the bus for free. We're also offering Christian Assembly t-shirts for $10 to wear together that day. Please sign up and pay in the narthex.
And we've already been making plans for the church picnic on August 11th. Can you believe we're already talking about summer activities already? Stay tuned for more information.
Have you noticed the new evangelism news flyers in your bulletin? All things evangelistic and outreach-oriented are mentioned in that flyer. Part of our calling as Christians is to be ministers of reconciliation. There's a part of our spirit man that can only be fulfilled by working out the Great Commission. If you're not already serving to bring Jesus to the lost and dying, read over the evangelism news and see how you can get involved. Hi, Mom.
That's all we have for today. Seek Jesus, love God, serve people. From all of us here at Christian Assembly, have a wonderful worship service.
That'd be funny. Okay, so what are we starting with? I'm getting myself ready, composed. You know, I gotta frame myself just right. Is it my turn now? Okay. We got this. We got this.
Yeah, we got it.
All right. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. It's a good deal.
Amen. You know, it really is true. You put a camera in front of someone, all of a sudden their demeanor changes. You get real nervous, like you're talking to a bunch of people, but you're really not just a camera, but it just takes you for a loop or something, right? You ever done that? It'll do. A couple more things on the back of your bulletin. You could look it over for yourself. So if you'd like to do that, all church miniature golf outreach, also camp, all the information for youth camp, children's camp out there in the Narthex area of our church. And there's some information about surrendering the secret. So read it over for yourself. Praise God. Be a part of what's going on. We appreciate that. You'll be blessed. At this time, it's a privilege and an honor to worship our Heavenly Father with the giving of our tithes and offerings. If you need an envelope, kindly raise your hand. And remember this, two offerings. Our first offering is for our tithes. Second offering is for our building fund, building maintenance fund, which, praise God, we thank God because of your faithfulness to give. We're a debt-free church and facility. Hallelujah. Isn't that wonderful to hear? Oh, your enthusiasm is a sky high today. We're debt-free. The church is a debt-free church. We don't have to twist arms or anything like that for people to give. Yeah, I told that to the Lord a long time ago. I'm not going to make any push for money. It's his work. If he can't support his work and give to his work, then who can? Right? Amen. Just give faithfully. Honor him. Give your tithe. Give your offering. Bless the Lord, and God will bless you back. Good measure. Pressed down. Shaken together. Running over. Let us pray and honor the Lord this morning. First, for your tithe. Second, for, what is it? Building fund. Amen. Let's go ahead and pray.
Oh, Father God, we do love, honor, worship, and adore you. And now we come before you freely to give of our tithes as an act of our free will and to just bless you and to bless this church and to give back just to such a small portion of what you have so richly blessed us. And now, Father, as we do give, we know that you cause it to multiply and cause it to accomplish all that you wanted to, and that as we give unto the church and the church gives unto the missions and all those that we support, we just thank you that all of their needs are met, and we just thank you that all of the needs of this church are met. And we also thank you, Father, that the blessing of the giver and the tither is ours. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Honor the Lord as you give.
Now I'm caught up in your presence. Jesus, you're all that matters. Coming back to what really matters. It's just your heart. Just wanna bless your heart, Jesus. I'm caught up in your presence. And I just wanna sing.
That says it all, doesn't it? Amen. You may be seated. We're going to dismiss our youth at this time. Praise God. That's all we need. All we need is Him. Praise God. Anybody in need of copy of the notes, kindly raise your hand. Our youth may be dismissed. Children's classes, whatever. You know who you are that need to be dismissed. You may be dismissed. Praise God. We thank God for teachers that teach our young people the truth of God's Word. They're not here just to be babysat. They're here to be taught the Word of God, trained into things of God. And once again, we thank God for all of our young people helping out this morning. We thank the Lord for their lives and just being taught the need for them to give back to God. Amen. To honor Him, serve Him. That's what it's all about. We serve Him. Do you love Jesus this morning? You know what? Know why He doesn't know us a thing? Because He gave it all. He's already given us everything that pertains to life and godliness. He poured out His life unto death for us. Anybody else need a copy of the notes? Just kindly raise your hand. We'll get them to you. Praise God. Praise God. All right, let's pray. Father, we just thank You so much for Your presence here among us today. We thank You for the person, presence, and power of Your Holy Spirit, who is our teacher this morning and guide. Enlighten us, open up our eyes and hearts, change us from glory to glory, put within us those things that You would have us to know and understand, that we might conform to the very image of Jesus our Lord and become that for which He shed His precious blood for us, that we might shine His lights in this world of darkness and hold forth the word of life to the generation that You've called us to do, that they might see our good works and glorify You, our Father, in heaven. We just thank You so much for the privilege of being Your ambassadors here upon this earth, that we can and we will reach out to this world to bring them into the place of saving grace. And Father, for all things this morning, we'll give You the praise, honor, and glory that You deserve. In Jesus' matchless name, amen. Amen. Praise God. This morning, I want to share with you and talk to you about walking in truth by faith. Walking in truth by faith. Our opening text is 3 John verses 3 and 4. There's only one chapter. Let's read the text this morning. For I rejoiced greatly when the brethren came and testified of the truth that is in thee. Notice the truth that is in thee. Even as thou walkest, notice, walkest in the truth. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in, notice, what is true. Walk in the truth. So it's so important for us to recognize and understand and know the need that we have to walk in truth. And I really want to emphasize that here this morning, and you're going to see why. It's a very important reason. But first of all, let me ask you a few questions, if you don't mind. Is that okay? And if you answer correctly, you'll get an A. All right? Did Jesus come? He did, didn't He? We should never celebrate that as just a religious activity or event. You realize the second person of deity left the glory world behind and robed Himself in human flesh to come to this earth for you and for me? Think about that. Wrap your brain around that. Number two, did He come and accomplish the thing that He set out to accomplish? Did He? Well, that's true because he said himself, Father, I have finished the work that you gave me to do. Now glorify me with the glory that I had with you from the very beginning before I left to come down here to the earth. Number three, did he destroy the devil himself? Did he defeat him? Well, Hebrews 2:14 tells us he became part of flesh and blood like we are. Why? So that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, the devil. Did he destroy the devil? Okay. Well, then next one, did he overcome death, hell, and the grave? Well, we just celebrated Easter, which is resurrection morning, resurrection day, and that means that death, hell, and the grave couldn't hold him down, none of them. He rose up victorious over all, and he's the victorious Lord of all. Right now, another question, is he seated at the right hand of the majesty on high, where he is now functioning in his present-day ministry as high priest, mediator, advocate, intercessor, and surety of the new and everlasting covenant? Does he stand behind every word of the new covenant and guarantee that he will see to it that it is made good on your behalf if you act in faith on what he has spoken in his word and said? Is that all true? Well, has he made salvation available to all mankind? Can anyone whosoever come and accept Jesus as Savior and Lord of their lives and be saved, be born again, washed in the blood of the Lamb? So far, you got A's. Next, did he come just to save us, meet our needs, and take us to heaven? You people are well taught. Well taught. No, not just to save us, meet our needs, and take us to heaven. He came to save us and make us his temple, to make us his dwelling place, to live inside of you, to live inside of me. And he came, praise God, as I said earlier, to live in people like us. What value does he see in us? Sometimes you have to admit you don't like living for yourself, who you are. You might not want to live in you. People say that all the time. But you know what? He saw some value and worth in you. And he made a decision, I want to live in that person. I hear it all the time. I don't like who I am. Well, you know what? God likes you so much. He loves you so much. He values you so much that he made a decision to pack up his bags and live inside of you. You're his temple. You're his dwelling place here upon this earth. You're special. You're important. He also came to fill you with his love, to fill you with his power, to fill you with his spirit, to fill you up and transform your life, to turn you into vessels used for his honor and glory here upon this earth. And that's a mouthful right there. He wants to love people through you. He wants to deliver people through you with his power. He wants his spirit to manifest himself in you and through you to accomplish his purposes in the earth like he did through Jesus our Lord. He also came to make you an ambassador, a representative of the highest order, serving him on this planet, carrying out the purpose of his will everywhere you go. Think about that. Jesus says, I've got to be about my Father's business. You know, we should have the same mindset that Jesus had. We got to be about our Father's business. I know we're busy. We got busy lives. But you know what? If we exclude being about our Father's business, then we're really not doing the right work. Because every single one of us has a ministry of reconciliation as ambassadors for Christ to let people know that God loves them. It's the goodness of God that leads to repentance. It is not guilt and condemnation that we heap upon people because they're not walking right with God and they're not serving God right. It's the goodness of God that leads people to repentance, and they got to see God in you. You know, you're supposed to be, and I'm supposed to be, his living epistle, read and known of all men. In other words, they don't hear what you say. They see what you do and how you act, and they see Christ in you, the light shining through your eyes, because your choices, your decisions, the way you live like your life, the way you conduct yourself is like a magnet, and it just draws them because they see you. They see you in the same workplace that you work, that they work. And you've got a completely different demeanor and attitude about yourself because you know Jesus. You don't just know of him. You are walking in truth. So also, Jesus came, listen, full of grace and truth. Why? To testify to the truth. To witness to the truth. Why? So that you and I can walk in truth. Now remember, when we say the word walk, we're now taking it beyond knowing. To walk is to take a path, a course of action. You may have a walking path wherever you walk. In your neighborhood, you may walk. My wife walks the dogs all the time. So she walks this particular path. But guess what? She can't just be standing there like this. What are you doing, honey? I'm being stationary with the dogs. No, walk the dogs. What does that mean? You live it out. A course of action. This is the course. This is how you live your life. Why is this important? Let me show you something. In John's Gospel 18, verses 37, 38. This is Jesus speaking to Pilate. Pilate speaking to Jesus. New Living Translation. Listen to what it says. Pilate said, "So you are a king." Jesus responded, "You say I'm a king. Actually, I was born and came into the world to testify to the truth. And all who love the truth recognize that what I say is true." Look at the next verse. A question so many people ask today, well, what is truth? And the sad part about that, he asked the question, turns and walks away. He didn't wait for the answer. What is truth? Pilate asked. Then he went out again to the people and told them, he's not guilty of any crime. Well, he should have waited for the answer. It might have impressed him. Why is this important? Because do you know ever since the fall of man, deception has ruled the world? Not truth. Deception has ruled the world. We can either take the path or walk along the path of deception, or we can walk the path of truth. And beloved, this is going to be a challenge for every single one of us for the rest of our lives. The decisions that we make will either be based on deception or truth. You know, it's almost deception when you get up in the morning and think that life is all about you. Ouch. What did I say earlier about, did he come just to meet our needs? But you know how easy it is for us to get caught up in what we need, and we want him to meet our need, and if things don't go right, if things don't go our way, then we define God and or we interpret him in our circumstances or the things that we're going through in life. This didn't pan out, that didn't work out, and so therefore it may not be the will of God that this happens, that happens, or whatever's going on. And rather than look to truth, we stay walking along the path of deception, thinking that this is how it is. Well, you know, it's not all about que sera, sera. It's not about what will be. It's about a decision that you and I make to discover the truth and walk in the truth and let the truth live through us. It's not about intellectually learning the Word of God. It's about living the Word of God. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, that's living in you. What's the difference? One involves intelligence. The other one is spiritual revelation that produces action in the life of the child of God. I don't just say, okay, I know the Bible teaches tithing. I tithe. Big difference between the two, wouldn't you say? I don't want to just know that Jesus is my healer. I want healing. What about you? In other words, we want to walk in the reality of truth, what belongs to us. I don't want to just say, I know I'm supposed to love my wife as Christ loved the church. I want to be loving my wife as Christ loved the church. That's reality. That's walking in truth. I want to show you something here. Truth or deception? Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 3, something that Paul said that he was concerned about. "But I fear that somehow your pure and undivided devotion to Christ will be corrupted, just as Eve was deceived by the cunning ways of the serpent. Of all the things he could be telling this church we know went through a lot of different things, but notice this here, he has a deep concern about their devotion to Christ to be what? Corrupted. How? Why? Just as Eve was deceived. To deceive means to present as truth what is a lie. That's his MO from the very beginning. Do you know that's how he began his whole attack against God and the things of God? Think about this. Go back to the very beginning with me just for a moment. And what do we see here? We discover that he deceived angels. Some say a third of the angels. Some say maybe not that much. Some say maybe more. It doesn't matter how many of the angels. We know they were deceived and we know that they followed him. But how in the world was he able to pull that off? Number one, it starts with him. Lucifer himself, what does he do? He studies God. He studies spiritual laws. He figures these things out in his head, I guess. And he makes a decision, I think I got this together now, and I am going to overthrow God. I am going to see to it that I lift my throne and exalt my throne above the throne of Almighty God. He, within himself, originates this whole thing called deception, if you want to say deceiving his own self, to think that he could possibly pull this off. But guess what? He's so convincing. He talks to these other angels and says, you know what? God's got I've got something more for you. If you continue serving God the way you are, here's the boundaries. You're never going to go beyond this. But you listen to me. And if you listen to me, I'll take you beyond those boundaries. I'll give you more and more and more and more. And so he finally convinced them, follow me. And together, we will overthrow God, and we'll rise up, and we will control the universe. You see that in movies all the time, don't you? Everybody wants to be a superhero, control the universe, and et cetera, et cetera. What do you think that originated? Well, the devil himself. Well, guess what? His plan was thwarted when God Almighty says, you may think you know laws, you may think you understand, but you're being cast down to hell, and your angels that follow you are going with you. Then he makes man in his own image and likeness, right? Adam and Eve creates them. Puts them in a perfect utopia, perfect environment, a perfect garden. He gives them authority and rule over all the works of his hands. And what happens? The same devil comes along and presents a truth or as truth what is a lie. And what does she do? Let's read it. Genesis chapter 3, verses 4 and 5, New Living Translation. You won't die. You know, prior to this, he said, what did God say? And she said, well, if we eat this fruit, we're going to die. And what does he say? No, you won't die. See, the truth is really this. The serpent replied to the woman, God knows that your eyes will be opened as soon as you eat it, and you will be like God, knowing both good and evil. You know, sometimes we just got to sit on a scripture and just pour over it. I'll tell you what, if I can make a suggestion to you, don't just read your Bible. Meditate the word. Did you notice something as I was meditating this? Did you notice something in that statement that he says, as soon as you eat it, you will be like God, right? So what does she do? She gets her eyes off her environment. She gets her eyes off what God said. She looks over at the tree, and she begins to think, could this be a possibility? Could this be real? How many of you got it just by looking at that verse so far? Something that a lot of people miss. Something that she really missed. How did God make Adam and Eve? In his own image, and she was already like God. She was already godlike. She was already there. It already existed. He crowned them with glory and honor. He gave them supreme authority over all the earth to rule the works of his hands, the fish of the sea, the fowl of the air, every creeping thing upon the earth. And what they were supposed to do is procreate and fill the earth with the glory of God, with others that were in the same image of the living God, the Most High God. That's what they were supposed to do. And he says something that's not true, but he presents it as truth, which is really a lie, to get her to think wrong. And
We've been living the lie ever since. What I just say about if we think it's all about us, you know that where that mentality came from? Right there in Genesis chapter 3. It started with Lucifer. He put it inside of Adam and Eve. Adam was just, he wasn't deceived. He just followed her. Can you see that? Well, guess what Eve did? She put off from herself the image of God. And she put on the image of the devil, of Satan himself. She stripped herself of the likeness of God. And she clothed herself with the likeness of the devil. You don't believe me? It got so bad that she reflected the image of the enemy. There had to be a flood. Because the heart of man was so wicked that God said, there's only one thing left to do. See, man was supposed to reflect the image of God in the earth, not the image of the enemy of God. So when we talk about self-centeredness and selfishness and being self-willed and self-sufficient and all the self things, that's exactly what happened in the fall. Man's focus is now not on what God created him to be, to fulfill his purpose, his destiny, his path that he had for their lives. Now they become as the devil was. It's all about me. It's all about me. It's all about me. You know why marriage is difficult in our society today? Because these two that are married have not stood before the throne of God and said, fill me with your love, with your power, with your spirit, so I can be changed to reflect your image, so I can be the best wife to my husband that he deserves that I be. And the husband hasn't said, come in to my heart, my life, change me from the inside out, teach me your ways, your truth. I submit myself to your will and fill me with your power, fill me with your love, fill me with your mercy, fill me with your grace, and give me the insight and understanding that I need so I can be the best husband that she deserves to have. That counseling session won't cost you a penny. It's free. I'll tell you what, right now, people don't really need deliverance. They need truth. They don't need counseling. They need truth. And that is the truth. And when I start living for my reason, the way I'm supposed to live, the way my created purpose is, that'll be the cry of my heart. When I get up in the morning, it won't be, oh, help me. I need this. I need that. No. Make me the shining light. Open up my eyes. Help me to see people through your eyes of love so I can reach out to them and lead them to your saving grace or be a blessing anywhere and everywhere I go. May my hands be empowered by your spirit so that wherever I go, I can lay them on somebody and set them free, deliver them. You know, healing doesn't come from without. Healing flows from within. I've got the life of God in me. You've got the life of God in you. You've got the nature of God in you. It's not about self. It's about giving ourselves. What's the Christian life all about? If a man will follow me, Jesus said, come after me, deny. First thing is what? Deny self. Take up your cross and follow my example. In other words, deny yourself the right to live independent of God. That's exactly what Lucifer did. That's exactly what Adam and Eve did. Deny yourself that right to live independent of God. Take up your cross means submit your will to the will and purpose of God, your creative purpose to be the person that God wants you to be. And follow me means look at his model and have a desire to walk in the same truth, the way he walked when he was here upon the earth. Praise God. Amen? Praise God. It's not all about just us. Look in the book of John, John's Gospel, chapter 8 and verse 44. Notice what Jesus said about the devil. And let me just say this too, is before we read that. You realize that he's not just a liar. He's the lie. He's not just a deceiver. a deceiver is who he is. It's his name. He's the deceiver. Okay. You, he's speaking to the Pharisees and the scribes, are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning. He abode not in the what? Truth. Because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father. You know what the father is? The originator, the source, the beginning. He's the originator of it. He is a liar. He is a deceiver. He uses lies, deceit, to do what? Control people's lives. Look at the book of Revelation, and we'll find out it's in the beginning, it's here now, and it will be in the end. Look at this. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil, and Satan, which, what's his job? Deceiveth the whole world. You know, we've been living in a lie. We've been living in deception. Ever since birth, we were born into the world of deception. How many of you had to train up your two-year-old to take back what belongs to them? Anyone? Wasn't it just built into them? Why do you think that is? How many of you had to train your child to brush their teeth? Everyone. Things that are evil, things that are wicked, to lie, to cheat, to steal, and all that, and to scream and holler and fight, perfectly trained, automatically trained. No school for them to go to be taught the behavior of selfishness, correct? But what about when it comes to walking in things that are right and just? Listen, we've had a son have coming over to our house just to train our dogs to be good, to do the right thing. See, we need trained in truth. And you know what? The church has missed that, especially over these so many recent years, because it's, and don't get me wrong when I say this, because you know I believe in it, and I preach truth. I preach faith to receive from God. And that's been really emphasized over the last so many years, but I think we've kind of left out that it's more than that. It's more than what I can get. It's what I can give that counts. It's transform me so I stop being the selfish person, self-willed person, self-sufficient person that I think I am. Help me to break free from the training I received from spiritual death as it was in my heart that trained me to act a certain way. Help me, we're going to do that in a moment, help me to stop thinking that it's all about me. And my emotions really are in charge of my life. And I am who my emotions tell me that I am. Help me with my understanding of my identity. Who am I? Am I a feeling? Am I emotion? Is that what I am? Because you see, it's very easy for us to just live by those feelings and emotions that contradict the Word of God, the will of God. Now, Jesus, when he came into this world, he came as the one who was testifying to the truth, which we just saw. Look in the book of John, chapter 1. Now, we read this all the time around Christmas time. We talk about the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Right? The Word was made flesh. But sometimes we're guilty of stopping right there. It says, we behold his glory as the only begotten of the Father. And what was he full of? Grace and truth. He was full of grace and truth, and he came into the earth to do what? Testify, as he said, to the truth, or witness to the truth. Why? Because the world was void of truth. Living based on how we feel, based on our emotions. You've heard the statement, the motto saying, if it feels good. Remember that mantra? Remember that? How that was always, hey, if it feels good, just do it. You're an entity in yourself. God is really in your own soul, in your own mind. You're really, God is in your brain. That's who God is. Go to, you know, a lot of these New Age teachings, that's what it is. It's all about you. It's about who you are. You know, the way you think, if it feels good, if it's the right thing that you think you should do, then you should just go ahead and be allowed to be that way. And we see it happening and escalating in our society even today. I never thought it would get this bad. You ever think it would get this bad? If you think you're a girl today, then use the girl's bathroom. If you think you're a boy today, then use the boy's bathroom. If you're undecided, then use the family bathroom, I guess. I don't know what you're going to... That would be funny if it wasn't so pathetic. Can you say amen to that? The problem here is here. And here. Can you see that? The truth liberates, the truth delivers and sets free. He came to testify to the truth. He came full of mercy, grace and full of truth to why? What reason? To bring truth into the world in which we live. And that's why when Pilate said, what is truth? No one knows. But Jesus said, I'm the truth. And matter of fact, look in Revelation in chapter 19, I believe it is. He was truth when he was here upon the earth. And when he comes again, notice this. And I saw an angel coming down from heaven. No, that's the wrong scripture. Chapter 19. This is Jesus. Chapter 19, Revelation 19, verse 11. Satan is the liar. Satan is the deceiver. And even in the end, he's going to be bound up into the pit so that he doesn't deceive the nations, which was that verse. We'll go back to that in just a moment. Notice this. Then I saw heaven open, and a white horse was standing there. Its rider was named, what's his name? Faithful and true. For he judges fairly and wages a righteous war. So when Jesus comes again, he's coming as faithful and true. Okay, go back to that other verse, chapter 20. Satan, when we enter the millennial reign of Christ for 1,000 years in chapter 20, notice this. I saw an angel come down from heaven having the key of the bottomless pit and the great chain in his hand, and he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil, and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years and cast him to the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal upon him. Why? Here's the reason. See, we get excited about that first part, don't we? Man, he's got his day coming. He's going to be bound for 1,000 years. Why? That he should deceive the nations no more till the 1,000 years should be fulfilled. Can you imagine the world without deception? And after that, he must be loosed a little season. But just listen to what that's saying. From the very beginning, he started in deception. With Adam and Eve, he deceived the angels. He deceived them or her, and then he followed. And from that point on, he's been trying to control the human race with the power of deception, which is all he has. That's his power. And it will continue on until he's bound up for 1,000 years in the bottomless pit. And for 1,000 years, he will not be allowed to deceive anyone anymore. Can you imagine living in a society that's deception-free for 1,000 years? Walking in perfect truth for 1,000 years? And I'll be honest with you, if we think that we're not deceived at all, we're deceived. You realize that? We don't know it all, do we? But my point was, when Jesus comes again, he's coming. His name is true. His name, that's who you are. When you see him, it's truth. Didn't he say, I am the truth? John 17, 17, what did he say? Sanctify them by thy truth. Thy word is truth. Can you imagine if Pilate just would have waited one more moment, Jesus would have told him when he asked them the question, what is truth? I am truth. My word is the truth. I'm the truth made flesh. You're looking at the truth. Can you imagine that? Which is why he said to follow him. And all these people today, and I'm sorry to say it, but in our society, it's a sad scenario and sad situation. Even in our government, they don't want to live by truth. People don't want to live by truth. Lies, deception, and all that, to get whatever they want to get, and so on. It's a corrupt society. And when you present the truth, guess what? People don't like it. They don't want to hear it. Now, I'm going to go a little bit further. Did you ever think the day would come that abortion would go from first trimester to second trimester to third trimester to warn, and then if they decide they don't want it, kill it. And as one politician just recently said, how about this? Kill them in the womb or kill them later. You ready for that one? You talk about eyes that need to be open. Kill them in the womb. If we don't kill them in the womb, we just have to kill them later. It's time for the church to wake up and stop being deceived. Save the whales, kill the babies. Save the whales, kill the babies. Save the eagles, it's an American icon. Kill the babies. You think God's going to wink at that? God's going to turn his face away from that? Are you kidding me? It's time to wake up, church. It's time to wake up and stop being deceived and realize what we're going through, realize what we're facing. Truth is at war with deception. Okay, a few scriptures here I want to throw out about truth. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 2. One of my favorite scriptures. Have I told you how many favorite scriptures I have? Have I told you yet how many favorite scriptures I have? Everyone's my favorite. Okay. Who will have all men to be saved and get all their needs met and one day move on to glory with me? Who will have all men to be saved? Everybody say, and. Once you get saved, that's the very beginning of it all. When you get saved, it's time to and come to the knowledge of the truth. God gave us this book, his word. Why? To communicate what is true and what is false. He who created us has the right to govern us. Can you say amen to that? Do we believe that even a little bit? He's the creator, we're the created. People are worshiping the creation rather than the creator, and they think that it's okay. They think that the earth came into being by itself. Some big old bang theory just took place, and all of a sudden, everything's from chaos is in perfect order. This book gives us a revelation of who we are, where we came from, and where we are going. It's all right here. He gave us this truth so that we could live our lives and conduct our ways, our walks, by the truth. Let me tell you about a lie. I said this on Wednesday night when I was teaching this. I grew up in a lie in church. A couple lies, probably more than one lie. But where I grew up in church, it was fear-based. If you didn't get your infant baby baptized, that child would die in original sin if they died as an infant baby. They would go to a place called limbo. And they would spend a particular time there, who knows how long, or if they would ever come out or float around in outer space somewhere in this place called limbo, and that's all there is to it. So it was a fear-based move where you were motivated by fear. Let me tell you something right now. God doesn't use fear tactics at all. And so, obviously, you've got to do what you have to do to get this baby baptized, and you've got to do it quickly because you don't want them to die and be in this place called limbo. Number one, no such place. Number two, when babies die, they go straight to glory to be with the living God. And that's in Scripture. How do I know that? David said, I'm going to go and be with him. He wasn't even a week old. I'm going to go and be with him. How does he know that? He knew. So he likes every man that comes into the world. If you die as an infant, you go straight to heaven. But the thing was, people are deceived into thinking, what about this one? I was taught also a place called purgatory. And in that place called purgatory, that's where you went to make atonement for your own sin. And no matter how good you were, how good you are, how much you practiced, what you did, say your prayers, all these penances and all these things that you did, guess what? When you die, there's a certainty you'll go to this place of suffering where you will pay for your sins, the atonement for your sins, until finally you're purged and cleansed, and then you could move to heaven. And we were told, I was taught, I'm only giving you truth, I was taught that there were books and there were things you had to pray out and there were candles of light, there were masses to pray, and you paid for all these things. You paid for them. But here's the thing is, we were so duped. Guess what? My grandmother died. I was crushed. 1969, I was 18 years old. Crushed. First close death in the family, my father's mother. 59 years old, young. Crushed. I did everything I could. I'll be by your grave, Grandma. I'm going to say all these prayers. I'm going to say a thousands of these and a thousands of those and a thousands of this. I'm going to do, and I just went on all the things I'm going to do. All these things to get you out of that place called purgatory. Grandma, I don't want you to be there anymore. But then I never thought, how much is enough? How many prayers? How long is the sentence? How long till she's purged? I have no clue. I have no idea. And so I just do it, and you pay money for it. And so finally, when I finally went and I got saved, I got born again, I went to my minister and said, I really want to serve. I've been born again. I'm washed in the blood of Jesus. I want to serve here in the church. Can you help me? Where do I fit in? But I have a few questions to ask you. And I asked about that one. His response to me was, since you know it, we won't charge you any money for your dead loved ones. But the church has to make money somehow. When I asked the other one, like, call no man father upon the earth, how come we do it when we're not? Jesus said, don't do it. He said, you can't believe what's in that book. He said, church doctrine is above that. You follow church doctrine, not the Bible. You want to know why I made my exit? Because Jesus is the truth. He's the way. It's not just a wonderful scripture to quote. He's the way. He's the truth. He's the life. Nobody comes to the Father except how? Through him. Look at, so we're to be saved and what? Come to the knowledge of the truth. You realize we should be rolling up our sleeves, studying ourselves to be approved to God, rightly dividing the word of truth. You realize that? The scripture says they're ever learning but never coming to the knowledge of the truth. That should be our quest. Once we get saved, we should be delving into this book, digging into this book and saying, Holy Spirit, stop all this. I want to learn history. I want to learn this. I want to learn that. Get a hold of the Spirit of God and just say, you're the revelator. You're the one that reveals to me the truth. We're going to see that in a moment. But teach me, show me, instruct me, and not just I can learn so that I can learn it intellectually. I want to live it. I want the Word to live in me and through me. That's what I want. So when people see me, they see someone different than anybody else that walks in that place of work, and you look like everybody else. Look at John 8:31-32. Jesus speaking, then said Jesus to the Jews, said it to the Jews which believed on him, if you continue in my word, you're my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Liberty comes from knowing the truth, experiencing the truth. That word know is that Greek word, epignosko, gnosko, and it talks about entering into the revelation, entering into the knowledge. It's like putting your finger in a socket, and you become one with electricity, and it just gives you a buzz, right? That's knowing it. That's what he's talking about. So in other words, not just intellectually learning it, but sitting there in the presence of the Holy Spirit and saying, change me so that that becomes a reality to me. Too often people just want to say, I read a chapter today, I read two chapters today. Great, I'm glad you did. But did it impact your life? Did it change your life? Did it make you a better person? Did it show you more love? Are you showing more love through your life? Are you being a brighter light everywhere you go? How you're living your life? That is what he's talking about. Changing us, transforming us from glory to glory, even by the Spirit of God. So we got to stay in the Word. To know, if we're going to be free from deception, we have to know the truth, right? Look at the next verse. Here in John's Gospel, chapter 16, verse 13, I just quoted it. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, who's the Holy Spirit called? Are you still out there or have you gone home? What's the Holy Spirit called? Spirit of truth. What's his duty? He will guide you into all truth. You know what? We need a travel guide. When it comes to truth and understanding truth, we need a travel guide. We need the Holy Spirit to give us the guidance that we need to understand what the truth is. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and will show you things to come. Now, let's roll up our sleeves. Are you ready for it? Okay, we need to know the truth. We need to walk in the truth. And if we've been saved, it's up to us to study, to show ourselves to be approved to God, a workman that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. We need to understand it. Now, here's the problem. In the book of Galatians, chapter 5, verse 16, here it is. We're probably going to stay on this for a little while. Is that okay? This subject for a little while? You ready for this one? This I say then, Walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would. Can I lay it out for us? Man's a tripart being, spirit, soul, and body. I talked about this Wednesday night. Say it with me, I'm a spirit. I have a soul. I live in a body. Okay, spirit and soul cannot be divided, okay? Can't be separated, I should say. We could divide them for you know, just distinction, to distinguish between the two, but the spirit and soul cannot be divided, so they're right here. The flesh is over here, the body. The moment you get saved, before you got saved, you didn't have much conviction about anything. Lying, cheating, stealing, as long as you didn't caught. I mean, right? Because the flesh, spirit, soul, and body, spirit, soul, and flesh, all lined up with whatever we encountered in life. We had no rules, no guidelines, and et cetera, et cetera. But all of a sudden, when you got born again, your spirit and soul detached themselves from your physical body and called for war. Your flesh, my flesh, call for all-out war against spirit and soul. The flesh wars against the spirit. The spirit wars against the flesh so that we can't do the things we ought to do. And what happens is this. We've got the one in the middle, the soul of man, mind, will, emotions, and intellect, right here connected to the spirit and soul. Now, the spirit and soul can't be separated. The flesh, it can be separated from the flesh. And when you die, that's proven to be true. The flesh stays here. Spirit and soul go to heaven, be with the Lord, right? Or the other place. That's it. One or two places. But the flesh goes back to the dust of the earth. So the spirit and soul can exist without the body. Okay, no time to teach on that. But here's the point. We've been so trained by the spiritual death that was in our soul that we're out here believing the lie, deception. And hey, if you get me angry, I'm going to get angry bad at you. You pass me up on a road rage, I'm going to give you, you never know what I'm going to do. I forgot what you do. I just, I'm so trained to walking in love. I just go ahead. You want to do that? Do that, I guess. Anyhow, you get my point? We've been trained. We've been taught that you lash out. Did she smack you? Smack her back. She holler at you? You holler her back. See, that's not walking in love. That's the flesh acting up and doing its own thing. Well, guess what? We're not to be controlled by our emotions, by our feelings, and by our flesh. Our flesh is not to dictate to who we are because they are not who we are. We're to be weaned from our emotions, David said in the book of Psalms. As a child is weaned from his emotion, from the mother, I'm to be weaned from my emotions. But here's the problem. We have allowed the devil to make us think that our feelings and emotions are who we are. They define us. That's me. He rules the life by guilt and condemnation and shame in doing so. But over here, this new man, even though you're a baby in Christ, you're a newborn baby, desire the milk of the word that you may grow thereby. Here's what's happening. Your spirit man is growing by the milk of the word, the milk of the word. You get to the meat of the word. You get stronger in the word. And this flesh over here that used to tell you who you are, sit down and be quiet. You rise up above it and say, get beneath me. I'm not a feeling. I'm not an emotion. I'm not moved. I walk by faith, not by, you see the fight? And look at Romans chapter 8, verses 1 and 2. We okay? There is therefore no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus who walk not after the flesh. Our walk is not to be after the flesh, but after who you are in spirit. That's your recreated spirit. For the law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. We've got two laws at work if you're born again. The law of the spirit of life is in your spirit over here. The law of sin and death is in your flesh over here. And guess what they're both vying for? The soul that's in the middle. Remember the Bible says, trust the Lord with all your heart. Lean not unto your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, he'll direct your path. That's the warfare. Over here, my feeling says, I'm sad. I'm a victim. And all of a sudden, we feel like as though we're going to be a victim. We're sad. We got to be sad. We got this cloud of emotions over top of us, and they're going to rule our lives, dictate our lives. Someone says something bad about you, like your hair's all messed up, looks kind of ugly today. And you got a pity party for a week. I'm a victim of someone's sarcasm and whatever. That's flesh. That's flesh. That shouldn't even bother us. I'm telling you, it shouldn't even bother you. You know why? Because that doesn't define me. That doesn't tell me who I am. You know who tells me who I am? The truth tells me who I am. Jesus tells me who I am. You know, when he says all that, you know, my response would be, but I look good on the inside. You should see me. You should see me in my spirit. I'm telling you, I'm glowing, and every hair is in place. And he knows all the ones that I lost. He put them back in there. They're all inside my spirit. And one day when this spirit and soul come back to the earth, and that body comes out, it's going to have a full head of hair. Everyone in place. Amen. You are not who you are in your flesh. You are not who you are in your emotions. We're to be weaned from our emotions. This is what the life of faith is all about. Walk in the Spirit. And what does the devil use? Guilt and condemnation. Condemnation, shame, guilt, condemnation to do what? Like a puppet on a string, control your life. Oh, I'm just so humiliated. It's not about you. It's not about you. You can't humiliate Jesus. And if I'm living by who I am in him, you can't humiliate me. Look at the next couple of verses in Romans chapter 8. For God has done what the law could not do, its power being weakened by the flesh, the entire nature of man without the Holy Spirit, sending his own son in the guise of sinful flesh and as an offering for sin. God condemned sin in the flesh, subdued, overcame, deprived it of its power over all who accept that sacrifice. Did you get that? So that the righteousness, so that the righteous and just requirement of the law might be fully met in us who live and move not in the ways of the flesh, but in the ways of the Spirit. Our lives governed not by the standards and according to the dictates of the flesh, but controlled by the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, but it's really the Spirit of God on the inside. So in other words, we've got this warfare that's going on, and where is it? Right between our ears. So our flesh wants us to listen to our feelings and emotions and to kind of gravitate towards this way and just say, you should get even with them. I don't get even with them. I get above them, man. I'm going to knock them in the head and do everything else. But the man on the inside says, you can't hurt me. I'm walking in love. Praise God. Jesus is alive in me. I'm not even paying any attention to you because, you know, I know who I am on the inside. There's two laws at work. That law over there is a law of sin and death. This law over here is a law of the Spirit of life. And guess what? This law is higher than that law, and that law that's bound us, that deceived us, that made us think that's who we are, we operate in that law of love and praise. I've got love in me, joy in me, peace in me, patience, kindness, goodness, meekness, temperance, and faithfulness. I'm living by that law, and that law is a thrust and lift, and that law is the law of gravity. The law of gravity is still working in the earth, and it's working in your body and mind, but praise God, I'm operating in the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus above the clouds of all that. Can you say amen? Or you can say, yeah, I guess I'm just a nobody. That'll lead you to an early grave. Don't say you're a nobody. Jesus paid for you with his blood. To say that is an insult to him. Look at the next couple of verses, and this is the biggie. These are the biggie verses. Look at verse 5. Wow. You ready for it? For they that are after the flesh, they do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity, an active force of rebellion against God. For it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. Which way is our mind leaning? Dare I even meddle on the way to church here this morning when there was a little bit of a disagreement between mom and dad, and the kids are sitting in the back seat, and they're getting antsy back there, and they're getting a little bit nervous back there. And no, it's your fault. No, it's your fault, honey. It's your fault. I told you to do this. No, I told you to do that. Calm down. Be the peacemaker. Be the peacemaker. Don't lean toward the flesh. I know it hurts our feel bads. Our feel bads are really, really emotions that we know are true. But we make a decision. I'm not leaning toward that. I'm just going to, you know what, it's a whole lot, the simplicity of the gospel is this, it's a whole lot easier just to live by who you are in Christ. It's that simple. Look at the next verse, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, because this is where the true battle comes in to play. This is our true spiritual warfare. I shared on Wednesday night, there was a group of people at one point, one time, they thought spiritual warfare was truly spiritual warfare. They actually did this. They rented planes. They went up in the air in the heavenlies. They flew their planes way up there. And then when they got up there, they actually had army fatigues on. They dressed themselves in army fatigues. They were the prayer warriors. They were going to go up there, and they're going to pray down strongholds. Spiritual strongholds is what they were going to do. And they thought the higher they get up there, the more effective that they were going to be. You could read the books on it. It's true. And there's always gullible believers as they'll fall for it, hook, line, and sinker. And you know what? The devil loves it. He says, come on, keep on doing it. Keep on having at it. Here's the true spiritual warfare right here. For though we walk in the what? Flesh. We do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Okay, what are those strongholds? Casting down imaginations. There are no imaginations up there, but there are many right here. And every high thing that exalts itself against the what? Knowledge of God. Ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. And bring into captivity every what? Thought unto the obedience of Christ. That is the spiritual warfare that we're all engaged in. The enemy's trying to tell you, God's not going to meet your need. Go back to the garden. All their needs were met. All their needs were met. Were they not? All she had to do was just say, I believe God. I exalt his word above what you're saying. Guess what? In Christ, God has supplied all of our needs according unto his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. And when I make that declaration of faith, guess what? It's a truth. It's a reality. I've got to walk in it by saying, I agree with it. Agree with God. Conform yourself to his will, and great good will come to you, we are told in Scripture. Get to know him. See, so our confessions of faith are not just me parroting someone else's scripture or whatever they say about God. I got a short. Does that help? Okay, I got a short. Anyhow, we agree with God. We've got to agree with God. Our confession, our declaration of faith is based on, I've sat before that scripture, I've viewed it over and over again, and I see that the scripture says, my needs are met in Jesus, so guess what? I'm not buying your deceptive lie, devil. My need is met. When the Bible says, by his stripes you were healed, we're struggling to get healed, and we've all been down this path. We're struggling to get healed. We're struggling to get healed. He says, by my stripes, you were healed. It's done. And the devil says, you're not going to get your healing. Not going to get your healing. It's time to start saying, too late. I'm healed in Jesus. It's on the inside now. I'm agreeing with it. Now get it to the outside by my declaration of who I am in Christ and what I have in him. I am whole. I am delivered. Oh, that's the one I love the best. Colossians 1:13 says he delivered us from the powers of darkness. People are trying to get delivered, trying to get delivered. You are delivered. Accept your deliverance. Start walking like it's true. Start thanking the Lord that you're delivered. And praise God, the devil will flee from you because he can't stand people that speak the word of God. I wish I could get through the rest of this, but I'll have mercy on you. Praise and worship team, come on up here. We're just beginning this. That okay? You're learning anything this morning? Hallelujah. You know that if you're looking at your clock, that's your flesh. Can we have an extra minute here today? Is that okay? There's just too much here that we need to know. Oh, hallelujah. Well, let's worship the Lord. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, are you redeemed this morning? Are you leaning toward the spirit or the flesh? Amen. With a renewed mind. You see why our minds need to be renewed to the truth Otherwise, he'll control your life through deception, period. That's all there is to it. But pray, isn't it easy to rise up in the morning and just say, oh, thank God, it's not about me. Not about me. It's not about me. It's about you, Jesus. You did it all for me. Holy Ghost, make it a reality in my life. I can love my wife like Christ loved the church. I can love my husband like he want me to. And children, praise God. Children, I just commit them to you, Lord. Help them and help me help them. Hallelujah. Oh, you supply my need. I don't have to worry or fret about anything. You know, wonder why he said that. Because you supply all my need. Let's stand up together, because between two things, this thing going crazy and me not wanting to stop, praise God. That's okay. Oh, can you worship him for all what he's already done for us, who we are and what we have and what we can do, because he's living in us. The greater one is in us than he that is in this world. Amen. Are you excited this morning? Is the greater one living in you? Has God of all eternity come down and made a home inside of you? You should be shouting from the mountaintops, God lives in me. God lives in me. Hallelujah, God lives in me. His life, his nature, his ability, all in me. Oh, let's worship. Hallelujah.
Grander earth's quake before, moved by the sound of his voice. Seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken from my regard. Sing it with us. But through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, it is where. Thank you.
If you come with a heavy heart this morning, or your emotions have been dictating to your life through oppression or anything of that nature, think of it along these lines. Don't let the enemy use your emotions to tell you who you are or to dictate to what you can do. No matter what you've been through, Jesus has made you a masterpiece on the inside. You let who you are within control your life. You lean toward what he said, not what the enemy said. Don't believe those deceptive lies. That is not your identity. That's not who you were created to be. You stand there in Jesus' name and start thanking him that you are delivered, set free, and made whole. And oppression will not control your life or have the key to your tongue and make you speak out those things that produce death. For death and life are in the power of the tongue. Begin rejoicing because you know who you are and you know what you have in him. And you'll watch God's hand move in a powerful way in your life. And lift up your countenance because he's the glory and the lifter of your head. Give the Holy Ghost something to work with and you'll see a change. Hallelujah. Amen. You know, before we're dismissed this morning, if you're here with us and maybe you've never been born again, washed in the precious blood of the Lamb, like I was for 24 years, even though I sat in church for 24 years, I was not born again. I wasn't a child of God. I wanted to go to heaven, but I didn't know how to get there. And so, praise God, thank God he sent laborers across my path to tell me the way. And I found that Jesus said, who's the truth, you must be born again. And I will exalt the truth of his word and what he said above anything, any religious tradition or anything of that nature. And when he says he's the only way to the Father, it doesn't matter to me what anybody else says in this culture, he's the only way. That's all there is to it, because he's the ultimate truth, the ultimate reality. He said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And how say you, how are you telling me, Philip, show me the Father? If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And if you don't believe me, then believe the works that I've done. But if you've seen me, you're looking eye to eye with the living God himself, the Father himself. That's who you see. Amen. Praise God. That's what he said. So I believe him. So if you're here today, I'm going to pray a sinner's prayer. Anybody, whether you're going to be viewing by social media, whatever, if you're here and you've never been born again, I'm going to pray this simple prayer. Pray with me. If you want to get Jesus, your heart, your life, make him your Savior and your Lord, then tell somebody before you leave that you've done so. Just repeat after me. Heavenly Father, I come to you just as I am, and I believe with all my heart that Jesus died for my sins and was raised from the dead for me. I open the door of my heart. I call upon the name of the Lord. Lord Jesus, come into my heart. I accept you. I confess you. I receive you as my Savior and my Lord. I deny myself to take up my cross and follow you all the days of my life. Heavenly Father, I've called upon the name of the Lord Jesus. According to your word, according to truth, I'm now your child. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise God. And if you pray that, like I said, for the first time, tell somebody that you came with. If you came by yourself, then tell one of us. Let us know. We'll give you some printed materials that you can take with you and grow in your Christian faith and experience. Hallelujah. Are you excited about what God is doing? Amen. Hallelujah. I know I am. He wants to take us to higher levels in him, and we're going to get there. Praise God. Are you ready for the ride? Amen. Don't forget, there's a teachers' meeting for all those who want to stay after the service is over. We appreciate your being here. We'll share some things with you. Let's pray. Father, we love you and thank you so much for your presence here among us today. Father, thank you for your word that changes us by your spirit from within, from glory to glory, faith to faith, grace to grace. We just thank you that we are your living epistles of the living Christ, known and read of all men. People do see you living on the inside of us as our light shines among men. They see our good works. They glorify you, our Father in heaven. Use us as ambassadors for you, as tools in your hand, instruments of righteousness to carry out the purpose of your will and bringing the world to you through our lives. We just thank you for this is our purpose and we will fulfill it. We will live to honor and glorify you and rejoice in all those that come. And Father, we thank you now as we depart for protecting us, keeping us safe, divinely protected, bumper to bumper, side to side, everywhere in between, by your holy presence, by the holy angels, and also by the blood of the Lamb. We thank you for keeping us safe on the road, all the animals off the road. And we just believe, dear Father God, that as we go, you help us cross paths with those that are nearest eternity, that we could lead them to your saving grace. In Jesus' name, amen. Give the Lord a shout offering and be dismissed. Praise God.